It's quite an adventure. Who's having it?
I wonder who is having this. You know, that's the very driving factor behind the whole self-inquiry process, is you ask something like that, you begin to look at who is it that's having this adventure.
Well, that seems like the most obvious thing in the world, doesn't it?
You would think so.
Like, you're having it, or I'm having it.
Yeah, but to me it wasn't self-evident. I didn't think to look back at who's having this. You know, like many people, I was out there in the field of objects in the world, trying to solve the problems out there. And the Maharshi came along and said, look, go back and look at who's having the experience.
Don't look at the object, look at the subject.
Because you'll never deconvolute the objects. Just too many of them. You'll never understand them all, derive them all. So just go back to the subject. Stroke of genius, I hadn't thought of it.
But see, I thought I had thought of it. I thought that, oh, well, there's no, you know, self there. That's just a kind of, you know, residue of the big corporate conglomerates creating your selfhood. Mm-hmm. And I thought that I had deconstructed all that. But in fact, I never actually looked back at the self. I thought it was self-evident, you know, if somebody said, you know, well, who's having this experience? Well, a Scorpio is, or, mm-hmm. you know, Rich is. But I never got sufficiently empirical on it, by which I mean, you know, just I didn't really try to observe, you know, okay, you know, Rich is having this experience. Where is he? Mm-hmm. Well, he's sitting in a chair right here. It's like, okay, well, I see this body sitting in this chair right here. Where is Rich? Well, Rich is the label that I use for the body in this chair. It's like, okay, well, where in his body is Rich? And so, like, in other words, I think I always pulled up short when I first started looking at self-inquiry, so it might be worth talking about or looking at sort of the need to be persistent in really looking and actually trying to find. It's not a clever thing. You're not saying, oh, there's nothing there. You're actually trying to find it. You're looking at it just like, you know, you're looking out at the night sky maybe with some binoculars and you want to see a particular star or part of the moon. It's just like that, isn't it?
Yeah, when you touched on it, when you ask the question, like you say, where are you? You say, well, I'm sitting here in this chair. You give your address or something, and that's the end of it. It's obvious, that's the final answer.
Oh, duh.
Duh. But you never think, well, that's the next question.
Yeah.
Once you start going down that trail, you start getting on the scent of the eye.
Yeah.
You begin moving down that trail, you say, do what you did. And they say, well, where inside this is Gary? And you think, well, feels like he's up here someplace. And you take the focal point of your eyes and nose and ears, and someplace in here, I know he's here someplace. Except that when you say, well, where are you? Because all day long you're up there talking to yourself, yelling and shouting at yourself and blaming yourself and imploring you to do better. And
it works hard. You have to give it credit for that.
Yeah, it works very hard. And you can wonder, well, now who's talking to who? Are there two people up there? And then somebody else comes on the scene, and you look at things like when am I? And you see, well, there's a whole bunch of Garys and Riches. There's like, you know, thousands of them. And it's like, well, who's running the show? You know, who's in charge of this place? And you can't find one.
Oh, but Gary, come on, that's just silly. They're all the same. You know they're all the same. You're just playing with words, right?
Except though, as we've implored people to do, if you look at when am I, you find that, in fact, as Virginia Woolf famously said, you have as many eyes as you have relationships. If you watch yourself in the course of a day, you can see every time you change the number of people around you in a relationship, a different person manifests to work with the situation.
I'm getting confused now, though. Who's watching?
Exactly.
and these other beings show up.
Yeah.
Like, you know, this sounds like a lot of work. You know, it's like I've already got a full-time job, hobbies,
that's
and things
right,
like this.
Right.
No, but it really does come down to this, almost what, you know, what the philosophers would call, oh, it's an infinite regress. You know, you have each question leads to another question. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. you have to really, it's not really so much a question as it is a search. Mm-hmm. It's not just a question. A question comes along with the search. You say, okay, well, it's located up in here somewhere because I hear it going on all day. Even just that question alone might be useful for people mm-hmm. to try to feel, where are they? Mm-hmm. Like, where do they feel that they are. Like if you know, without going too fast, going slowly, and just saying, all right, so if you're right here sitting in the chair, where are you? Mm-hmm. And I can sort of not find any particular place in my body when I look. It's almost a kind of scanning. Yeah, we say look, but our eyes are really for optical phenomena. But if we, you know, scan with our senses and say, okay, where is it? I can't really find it.
No, and you can watch it move as you pick up your tea and you drink your tea. Mm. You know, the eye runs down to the mouth, the taste buds. Mm. When you hear something, then the eye runs up to your ear. And you feel something in your toes. Like, well, now I'm down here. You can see yourself moving, flashing around inside as your sensory perceptors sweep through this body.
But wait, where is that self that's watching the sensory perceptors
exactly
sweep through the body? That's the one we're really after, isn't it?
Look at him. And you say, well, okay, who is watching this dance go on? And we've done the classical logic thing of saying, well, if I can objectify something, it can't be me. It must be different from me. And so I begin looking around and seeing, what can I objectify? And you begin looking and you find out, and keep working your way back to the ultimate subject that cannot be objectified. You just keep turning around. That stops the infinite regress. When you turn around and you keep going back and you touch on a very key point, is feel it. You can feel your way around and you can say, well, what do I feel like I am? You can feel yourself moving around the body, as we said. You can feel yourself up here. But there's no one place where you can feel yourself staying. You're all over the map until you go back and say, well, okay, there's something watching all this take place. It's been watching this stuff take place for decades. It hasn't moved, and then I can't find out where it is.
It's observing right now that maybe we should repeat that. If I can objectify something, then I'm not it, right? So let's say I have some clay, and I'm as skilled as the craftsman is that made this, so I make a cup. And I may identify with that cup, I may be proud of that cup, I may sell that cup.
My cup.
Yeah, but it's not me.
No.
It's clearly not me.
No.
Right? We would never make the mistake of thinking that it was me. We would never wake up in the morning and say, oh my God, I'm not a cup.
I'm over there, sitting on the table.
Right.
The tea in me.
And we can do that systematically. Now, it's very interesting to feel it again, where we very much might do this with some things like a car, or our phone, or a sports team, or, you know, that we say, oh, like implicitly think, that's me.
I lost my iPhone, but it's not really me.
We lost the game.
We
the
lost
other day.
The game.
But we know, we feel, we know interiorly that we're in fact not that car. Mm-hmm. We know we're not the iPhone. Mm-hmm. Like there may be a blurriness there that doesn't accompany our ordinary experience of objects. But still we know that that is an object. So we know that that can't be us.
Because if it goes away. So the car goes away, you lose your iPhone.
I'm still here.
You're still here.
Yeah, strangely.
And you look at your body and you say, well, am I my body? I must be my body. You say, well,
that seems convincing, that one.
Hold it. Yeah. But I'm, you know, I watch as I age. And in fact, this watching.
You don't age, Gary.
Whatever. The watching doesn't seem to change. And yet, clearly, the body changes. You know, it gains weight, loses weight, hair changes, taller, shorter. You can just watch the body change. So you can't be that because there's something here that's watching all this take place. It's doesn't appear to be changing at all.
Every time I cut my toenails, I experience like, well, I'm certainly not my toenails.
No, right? That should eliminate that.
Right. And then we can sort of systematize, like, am I my saliva? No. Am I the breath circulating through me? Well, no. That's transient. Am I my blood? No, I can give that away and still be here. You can say, well, you can't give it all away. It's like, well, that's true, but you systematically look at the body and you see, just as you couldn't find yourself anywhere in particular, even if you kind of ordinarily feel like you may be in some particular location, like, and I think for most people it's either, as you had, at the head or in the belly, it's like where people are, they think. We can pretty systematically look, it's like, this is a dynamic thing. But I experience that unchanging quality. Yeah. That you mentioned, where, you know, I have always been me, whatever that is, so it can't possibly be these changing things. So it can't be something that I can objectify mm-hmm. and put in the world, because that can go away and I remain. Mm-hmm. It can't be my body, which I can kind of objectify because I can observe it and I can even remove parts of it and still remain.
But just for a second there, I mean, if we are this body, we should be able to interrogate our hand and watch it, you know, give us information on what it's like inside the hand. How's it going? What's going on in there? If that's really us, we should have some reporting ability.
Well, we get reporting ability from our senses. You know, it says, no, hey, it's hot over here. No, stay away from the stove.
Right, but as far as functionality, you have no idea what's going on when you do something like this. You say, well, it's moving. Well, tell me about the ligaments and tendons and blood and muscles and nerve senses and everything else that's going on. We have no idea what's going on in there. Or in here.
Yeah.
We have anatomical pictures. We have no idea what's going on in here. Or in here.
Yeah.
None. Zero.
Well, it just might be that great unknown part of us.
It's clearly it's a great unknown. Yeah.
And it might be unknowable, right? You know, maybe only, you know, a lover can know what's really going on in our hand.
Perhaps.
Or something. But really, if we pursue that logic too, we see that
nobody
knows what's going on.
Or even how it is done.
So we can't be the body. No. Be the cup.
No, even our thoughts. We think our thoughts. We become hypnotized by our thoughts and believe we are our thoughts. And yet we can see.
I was just thinking that.
Yet we can see the thoughts come and go. If we watch carefully, we can see that we don't think them up. They just pop up. And you can make more or less of them. And you can, as we found out, make less and less and less of them until they don't come nearly so frequently. And even when you are not with thoughts, so you're off from an activity, you still continue to exist. There's still functioning taking place, even when the thoughts aren't there.
So even though the thoughts are very convincing, like I have to think about going and, you know, picking up my car from the mechanic, and that's who I am. I am the one who goes to the mechanic and picks up my car. In fact, that's not me either, because that's just coming into existence and going out of existence. Right. But you keep alluding to this mysterious character who can observe the sensory things happening in the body and can observe, you know, thoughts coming in out of that. That part remains a little bit mysterious. You know, who is this character that is observing the thoughts coming into being, right? You know,
if we do a meditation exercise and just kind of stand out on our thoughts and look back at what it is that's looking out, you'd say, I can't see anything back in there. You should be able to. You know, logically, if you're standing out on the object looking back at the subject, you should be able to objectify the subject. You look back and there's nothing there. There's just nothing to be seen. So that gives you an idea that this witness that felt so constituted and so organized as to be there present all the time is now can't be seen. But now it's moved out to standing out there on top of the stream of consciousness, stream of thoughts out there.
It's just watching.
It's just watching from out there now.
It's a bird.
It was watching back here. Now it's out there looking back here and it can't see anything here.
But it doesn't not see anything there either. It doesn't see an absence of anything either. I think that...
It's the same watching taking place.
Yeah. There's just the watching.
There's just watching taking place. Verbi.
Watching is present.
Watching is present. There's no watcher. If you dig into the watcher, you can dig into that the same way and go into the core of it, and you find, in fact, there's nothing there watching. There's just watching going on.
Yeah. And you go into the watching, and it feels interesting. It feels energizing. Mm-hmm. It feels joyous. It's not a disappointment that there's no watcher there. That you look back and it's incredible that there's no watcher there, that there is just watching. So at that moment, you're just watching. and that's what you are, the watching of watching.
Well, you can watch when you come out of it. If you hear what you're saying, being fully present as it is watching, and something comes in to bring an object into consciousness, you can feel the concretizing of the pure watching into a watcher, a subject with an object, a car or whatever. Yeah. You can watch that appear, and you can feel the energy change from watching to oh, I have to go pick up my car.
Yeah, anyway, how much is it going to cost?
Exactly. You can feel, restful size feeling, you can feel how different that feels as you move into, I've got to go pick up my car, as opposed to being just pure watching.
Yeah.
The watching's still going on, you just now superimposed upon it a subject and an object forming an action.
And it just sounds strange linguistically, right? So I'll try to use an analogy. I swim regularly, and when I do my laps, for the longest time, because I never really had any instruction or anything, lessons when I was a kid, but I never had any real coaching, I would just breathe on one side. Mm-hmm. And I recently, got some advice from a swim guru, and he's just like, hey, try doing three, breathing from side to side. Oh, at first...
Yeah,
I mean, it just doesn't. It's a kind of very counterintuitive movement because it's so habitual what I had been doing, and I think it's the same thing. Looking out or looking in, is the watcher looking out, or is the watcher looking in? You just have to turn your head to the other side. Mm-hmm. We're not at all uncomfortable with the idea that the watcher is just looking out there in the world, saying, "Oh, look, there's a bird," or "Look at that car," or "Look at that guy over there," or "Where's my chainsaw?" Mm-hmm. We're very comfortable with the idea that there's that form of awareness, but for some reason it just doesn't make sense to people, maybe because of the evolutionary context that we evolved in, to turn it around and look at the watcher, the watching. And it's just a little weird like that at first. It's just like using your left hand if you're right-handed, mm-hmm. And just do it enough that it no longer is strange. You start to have kind of ambidexterity between, your usual kind of technique of scanning the horizon for food and drugs and just to talk about what consumption is about, basically, and using that same scanning mobility to just look at watching. It's nothing mysterious. It doesn't require a special technique, but the questions can be very useful to get us to that. Who's having this experience? Right. When is this experience occurring? Where is this experience occurring?
Yeah, I think if you don't, your point about evolutionarily evolving an eye, we evolved one for certain Darwinianly useful purposes, and the question now is, we were never really tasked with, is there an evolutionary value to going back and looking at what it is that's watching? In fact, it looks like we may be evolutionarily now disadvantaged by having this predominant eye appear to be running things. And if we do this turnaround thing, which you talked about, it's very useful, just turn back and look, you may find a more evolutionarily useful way to be, which is less stressful, more productive, much more joyous than what you had before when you believed you had a subject there.
It's an evolution of consciousness.
It's an evolution of consciousness. Right.
Consciousness, finds itself in this I-thought rut. And all it knows how to do in this niche is I, and it's saying, hey, that was really specialized, technique you're using for whatever context that, it might have even been, what they call a spandrel, like our chin, it just comes up because the two jawbones go together. There's no particular function to the chin. Mm-hmm. It may have just been that we focus our senses together enough that this I thought comes into being. But it's clearly disadvantageous now, and we don't need to just evolve on the physical level, given that we're not just physical beings. We can evolve on the conscious level. We can use our consciousness to look at consciousness and say, hey, what's going on back there? Mm-hmm.